Hello friends, welcome to another investment banking tutorial from Wall Street Mojo. Today we are going to discuss about free cash flow to the firm formulas. Basically, we are going to discuss the top three FCFF formulas that you must know. But before you get into this video in depth, I would highly recommend that you have a look at our earlier video which discussed what is free cash flow to the firm and how do you develop intuitive understanding of what this is all about. So at the end of that video, we came to a logical understanding that free cash flow to the firm is nothing but the sum total of cash flow from operations and cash flow from investment. So it's basically CFO plus CFI. But here what we are going to do is we'll just take a step ahead and move forward and see how analysts actually go into these details of bifurcating the CFO and the CFI. So let's get started here. So as we discussed in our intuitive video, free cash flow to the firm, the formula is basically the cash flow from operations plus the cash flow from investments. So I would highly recommend that don't worry about the plus and the minus signs here if there are any, because what we essentially talk about is whether this is a cash inflow or a cash outflow from the company point of view. Okay, so if you are thinking about cash flow from investments, how that can be a plus, you're right. Cash flow from investments is basically nothing but the capital expenditure. So this has to be an outflow. So you can also call this as a formula like, you know, CFO minus CFI. That's okay with me. But remember that this CFO can also be an outflow or an inflow. So it can come with a minus sign or a plus sign. So please do remember, free cash flow to the firm, in an intuitive way, we define this as CFO plus CFI. But now we are going to take the top three ways in which analysts define the FCFF formula. Okay. So this is number one that we are going to take right now. So FCFF is nothing but EBIT. This is the earnings before interest and taxes. It's also called as the operating profit multiplied by 1 minus tax rates. Okay. EBIT into 1 minus tax rates plus your non-cash expenses. Your non-cash expenses are nothing but the depreciation and amortization primarily, but there can be other set of non-cash expenses that may flow through your income statement. Something like losses and gains, restructuring expenses. We'll come to all of that later, but primarily think of non-cash expenses as the depreciation and amortization, right? And then the third item basically comes here is the changes in working capital. Now, changes in working capital is again very important. Here you really need to understand what is working capital. All right, so I'll just come to this in a moment, and let me just write the whole formula first. After this changes in working capital comes the capex or the CFI. So I'll write with the minus sign because assuming that the capex is always there. So this is the whole formula for free cash flow to the firm. Now, as I said earlier, EBIT is nothing but operating profit. Tax rate is the tax rate, the corporate tax rates. Non-cash expenses is the depreciation amortization. The working capital here is primarily consisting of the core working capital. That is, think of the inventories. It can be receivables. It can be inventories. It can be payables. So primarily these are the three things that you are considering here in the working capital. So you need to track the changes in working capital, not the absolute number, but the changes in working capital. So one has to be very careful when we talk about working capital here. There could be items which are beyond receivables, inventories, and payables. Okay, so something like debt, a presence of debt in, let's say, current liabilities. Of course, there could be, like short-term debt. Now, should you take it or not? The clear answer is that you shouldn't take debt as a part of this FCFF formula. And there's a very specific reason attached to it. If you look at free cash flow to the firm, this basically it forms a part of the discounted cash flow approach. Now, this discounted cash flow approach, when we use the FCFF, it gives you the valuation of the whole firm. Okay. Now, this valuation of the home firm, in order to arrive the valuation of the equity or the valuation from the point of view of shareholders' equity, the valuation of the debt needs to be removed at that point of time. Now, if there's a value which you have found from the firm and there's some value which is attached to the debt, if you pay back the debt holders whatever they are obliged to get, what we get in return at the end of the day is the shareholders' equity value. So ultimately, when we do DCF or the discounted cash flow to the firm, we're trying to find the equity value, the fair value of the stock, which is the shareholders' equity value, right? So here what happens is we adjust for the debt at the very last step and not here in between any kind of a formula. So we need to remove or not consider this debt here at this point of time. All right. So that's how it is. So this was the number one formula for free cash flow to the firm approach. So let's discuss the second formula of free cash flow to the firm here. The second formula for free cash flow to the firm is nothing but a mathematical variant of the earlier formula which we have written. It basically subdivides this EBIT into 1 minus T into various parts. And the second thing which is important here is to understand this non-cash expense. Primarily, if you will see throughout the valuation exercises, non-cash expenses are primarily depreciation and amortization and things related to restructuring and losses and other things. They don't occur very frequently. So you can think of this as depreciation and amortization primarily. All right. So when we consider free cash flow to the firm as a second formula, it actually starts with the net income. So when you have your income statement, it starts from the bottom, the net income. Then it adds back your depreciation and amortization, which is a non-cash expense. All right. So think of depreciation and amortization. Okay. Now this is added back, plus it also has an element of interest into 1 minus tax. I'll just tell you, where this is coming from. But basically, you can see that the first two terms, EBIT into 1 minus T and the non-cash expense on the top here, this is nothing but these three elements here. All right. I'll just go ahead and prove what do I mean by this. And the remaining thing actually is more or less the same. So changes in working capital and capex. Let's go ahead and actually prove this as the formula. So if we start with EBIT into 1 minus T, EBIT into 1 minus tax rate is 1. This can be written as EBT into 1 minus T, right? Plus can be written as interest into 1 minus T. I hope it is easy to see that EBIT can be written as EBT plus interest, right? So it is EBIT's earnings before interest and taxes. So I can write this as earnings before taxes plus interest. So it's one and the same thing. Now in the second step, I multiply this by 1 minus T. So in both the areas. So what I get is earnings before taxes into 1 minus T is nothing but your net income or profit. And the second term that we get here is interest into 1 minus T. That is the tax rate. So that's how we get these two terms. So this first term and the second term, both of them are here. Depreciation and amortization is nothing but the non-cash expense. The working capital and capex is basically coming from the earlier formula. So it's a part of the formula already. So this is how the second formula comes into picture. You can use any of the two formulas, whichever you like. Answer is going to be obviously the same because it's coming out to be the same mathematically, right? So that's how it works. So now that we are done with the two set of formulas, let's move and look at the third formula, right? Now this formula actually starts with EBITDA. And mathematically, it's one and the same thing. So it starts with EBITDA, EBI. EBITDA. EBITDA is nothing but earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation and amortization. This is multiplied by 1 minus tax rates plus your depreciation and amortization into your tax rate plus your changes in working capital minus capex. So obviously when you are looking at these two terms, it's basically constant in all the three formulas. The only thing that's changing is the first two, three elements. So the first one started with EBIT, the second one is starting with the net income, the third formula starts with EBITDA. So it's very easy to reconcile this third formula with the first one when we write EBITDA like this. EBITDA is nothing but EBIT plus depreciation and amortization into 1 minus tax, right? So it comes out to be EBIT into 1 minus T plus your depreciation and amortization into 1 minus T, right? So this is what we had in the first formula, right? Now only the difference is the second thing, right? And we also have this another element called depreciation and amortization into tax. So when we add this depreciation amortization into tax, the sum total of this and this is nothing but depreciation and amortization. So you can actually do and see. So this is depreciation amortization minus depreciation amortization into tax plus depreciation amortization into tax. So these two get subtracted and what we get is this number. So essentially we can reconcile all the three formulas very easily. And if you ask me what's my preference in terms of how I proceed and use which kind of a formula, I typically use the first set of formula, which starts with EBIT, which is the operating income. And I don't know why it is my personal favorite, but it comes out to be very easy in terms of application. As you will see in other examples, which I'll show next, is that I have used this first set of. So now that we understand the top three formulas for free cash flow to the firm, let us see some applications of these formulas. The very first one is this Alibaba free cash flow to the firm. Here, basically, Alibaba came up with its IPO in 2014. And at that point of time, I analyzed the cash flows and did the financial modeling of the company and realized that its free cash flow to the firm has always been positive and was increasing. So here's the snapshot of its projections. If you want to download this model, you can download it from this website, wallstreetmojo.com. And it's a simple one-step download. You can also see that the formula that I had used here is basically the formula number one, EBIT into 1 minus T. You add the depreciation and amortization, adding the changes in working capital and subtracting the capital expenditure. So basically, I have used the first set of formula. That's pretty much I like because it's kind of very easy to deploy. That's one of the reasons. And when you are doing the discounted cash flow analysis, one part which is very important is that you have the annual reports. And when you get those annual reports, the historicals are the results which are already declared. So this snapshot is divided into two parts. This is what has been declared in terms of its results. And forecast is something that you are expected to do as a financial analyst. So that we call it as financial modeling. So once you're done with financial modeling, you will be able to forecast the free cash flow to the firm, the FCFF. So the particular trend that we observed was that they were growing and increasing. So that's what is the most important thing to note about Alibaba. The second example was related to Box IPO, which I had analyzed in 2014. And here was a totally different story altogether. Again, the free cash flow to the firm formula that I had used was the first one, started with EBIT into 1 minus T. But another aspect which you can see here, which is in contrast with Alibaba, is that this has a negative free cash flow to the firm and it's kind of decreasing, right? Only in January 2019, it starts to reverse some kind of trend, which we still are unsure of. So valuing Box using free cash flow to the firm approach can be very difficult, and you may have to apply different other tools like relative valuation to value such kind of firm.